God bless you, beloved. It is always in our heart to encourage the saints of God to continue in the faith. You know, we are living in the last days, in the last hours, the last seconds of this age. This age is soon coming to a close, called the Age of Grace. And this is the time right now that God is reaping the final harvest right before the kingdom age begins to come. And right now we're on the precipice, the very cusp of the kingdom of God coming to earth as God promised. But before the kingdom of God comes and Jesus establishes kingdom in his rule and reign with the saints on this earth, there's going to be a time of tribulation. Jesus put it this way, there's going to be a time where it's going to be so terrible that no age and time before have ever experienced the things that are going to come upon the earth. And some of these apocalyptic events taking place in our world and on this planet today, you know, it's just kind of like people need to see that the signs are telling us everywhere that the soon return of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is right upon us. And so this is why we encourage, this is why we warn, this is why we teach, we preach, we post the videos on YouTube. And so we want you to be not caught unaware, because there's a lot of people right now, particularly church people, that are asleep. They're ignoring the signs, and some people don't even have a clue of the things that are going on in their world today. You know, if you're just looking at your local news, you're finding out all of the crime and the drama that's going on in your little city, township, or wherever. However, if you look at the news on a worldwide scale, you will see that there are things that are cataclysmic that is happening all over this planet, from floods to earthquakes to tsunamis to meteorite showers and all kinds of things that are going on, you know, sunspots and so many things are going on. And Jesus said this will mark the end of the age in which we live, you know, earthquakes in diverse places. You know, he talks about the sun and the seas and the waves roaring. You know, he talked about men's heart failing them for fear. He talked about pestilence and all types of things that are happening in our world, wars and rumors of war. You know, we look at the Middle East right now, which is a powder keg. It's just in turmoil. The Bible talks about even the destruction of Syria. And we're looking at that unfold right now in our time. You know, this has never happened in the history of the planet. It's one of the oldest cities in the world. Matter of fact, the Apostle Paul was on his way to Damascus when he met the Lord. And right now, if you look at a before and an after shot of Damascus, you see exactly what I'm talking about. And so all of the different players, the nations of the world, are aligning against Israel. Just a few weeks ago, we see that there was 70 nations that had come together to actually divide the land of Israel. Thank God it didn't happen at the time, but I believe that it's going to happen eventually. But it didn't happen, and once that happens, you know, the Bible says to Abraham in the 12th chapter of Genesis, he said, "I will curse those who curse you, and I'll bless those that bless you. And in you shall all the nations of the earth be blessed." And all the nations of the earth came against Israel. All 70 nations just came against Israel. And it didn't happen. Thank God the saints of God prayed. Thank God that the timetable right now, I don't believe it's the time in order for them to do that. God stayed that particular judgment. Because if they would have divided the land of Israel, it would have been hell on earth with the nations that were responsible for dividing it according to the book of Zechariah. And so right now we're looking at these things unfold in the news, worldwide news. And so what am I saying these things to you for? Because right now it's time for us to prepare. Can I share a scripture out of the book of Romans? Paul said to the church at Rome in chapter 13, he says in verse number 11, "And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed." Notice he says, our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. And he was talking about it in his day. In verse 12, he said, "The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in licentiousness and lewdness, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provisions for the flesh to fulfill its lust." So right now, it's high time for us to wake out of our sleep. You know, for some parts of the church, they're not asleep. They're comatose. You know, they have no clue of what's going on. And so Jesus told us the fulfillment of all these things are at hand. And so we need to really pay attention to what's going on. We need to pay attention to the signs. We particularly need to pay attention to what's going on with the nation of Israel. But one other scripture I want to just share with you out of the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 13. The Bible says here in verse 5, examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Prove yourselves. In other words, put yourself to the test. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you unless you are indeed disqualified? So once again, he says, examine yourselves. I did a teaching and it's posted on YouTube years ago at a little church that I was pastoring. I did a teaching entitled The Counterfeit Conversion. And that's one of the scriptures that we took out of that particular scripture, because one of the things that I'm noticing that is happening in the churches today, especially when preachers are having altar calls and calling people to Christ, you know, one of the things that they say, you know, give God your heart, you know, give your heart to Christ and things like that, which, to be honest with you, is not even scriptural. Jesus gave us the formula for salvation. When he first came on the scene, he told us to repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And the apostles after him preached, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. And he said, for remission of sin, that your sins may be blotted out or remitted. So when you're talking about remissions, it means sending away of sins. And so that's what the word remit means. So you got to understand that there's a formula for salvation. And one of the things that I'm seeing is that people are forgetting one of the main courses, our main ingredients, let's say, of salvation, and that is repentance. There's so many people right now, they say they're saved, they're Christians, but their lifestyle does not is not evidenced by their actions. And so when we repent, that means that if we were going left, we're now going right. If we repented, if we're going south, that means we're going north now. If we truly repented, that means the things that we were doing that were unlawful are now the things that we're doing that are lawful, that are permitted in God's kingdom. And so seeing too many of this, I want to encourage and challenge the pastors, go back and examine what the Bible says about true salvation, because many people have a counterfeit. And I'm afraid, my beloved, that many people, when the trumpet sounds and the dead in Christ rise first, some people are not going to rise that are in the grave already. There are some people that I believe that are even alive and remain that will not be caught up, even though they call themselves Christians. Because the Bible tells us to cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of life, of light rather. And so I just want to share this from my heart, because I truly see this thing happening in many places that I go to. I've heard a pastor say one time before, you know, he says, you just pray this prayer and you'll be saved. That's what the Bible says. You know, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God's raised from the dead, you shall be saved. And and that's it. You're saved. I've seen them come to my altars. You know, and I praying with them and, you know, chewing gum and just, you know, like, hurry up, preacher, I want to get this all over with. You know, the game's coming on early, soon. And, well, I got to get home because, you know, after all, my boo's going to call or something like that. You know, and so they just want to get it all over with. And they feel that, hey, I've prayed that prayer. So therefore, but no. When the Bible talks about believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, listen, if I'm in a building and somebody comes out of the back of the building and say, fire, fire, everyone get out. And I stay right there in the building in the same place, sitting down at my desk, my cubicle, and I'm just working and things like that. You know what? The reason why I did not respond to the warning is because I didn't believe it. Now, you may not have smelled the smoke. You may not have seen the flames or felt the heat. But if the guy comes in and say, with no evidence, you know, hey, get out, everybody, get out. There's a fire in the building. You know, if I believe without seeing the signs, if I believe without seeing the evidence, then I will act. That means I'll get up and run out. You follow what I'm saying? So if I truly believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, then my life will act like there's a fire, and I've got to change my position in order for me to be saved. So people, I want you to understand, if some preacher told you that just because you prayed those prayers or you said those words, let us say that way, if you said those words that you're saved, that does not constitute that you are truly saved. The Bible tells us many of the people of Israel came out of Egypt, but they were overthrown in the wilderness. Why? Because they did not continue with God. They did not listen to God. They did not listen to his commands. They weren't faithful to him. They were glad to be out of Egypt, out of bondage, out of slavery. But guess what happened? Their hearts wouldn't change. They got into the wilderness. And you know some of the things that they did? They committed orgies. They committed abominations. And you know about the golden calf. Amen. And so as a result, they broke God's commandments, the covenant that God was trying to make with them. And that's the same thing. You remember Moses said, who's on the Lord's side? Many of them died that day, they perished. You remember the ones, you go back in the Bible and you see the Bible says that there are thousands of them fell in the wilderness because of fornication. Because of sexual sins. See, they didn't continue with the Lord. They didn't continue in the word of God. So as a result, they were destroyed or overthrown in the wilderness. What am I saying to you today? How does this apply to me, preacher? It applies to you because if you don't continue in the faith, if you don't continue in the word, in the laws, in the commandments of the Lord Jesus Christ, then guess what? Even though you prayed that prayer out of your mouth, you said all the right things. Remember, Jesus said, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And God honors the prayer that's prayed from the heart. The thief on the cross didn't say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart, you know, save me from my sins. The only thing he says, Lord, remember me when you come into the kingdom. And Jesus said, this day you'll be with me in paradise. Well, what was Jesus saying? He's saying, you made it in, brother, not because you said all the right things, because your heart was in the right place. You remember what he said before he even prayed that prayer? He said, why are you bothering Jesus? This man didn't do anything wrong. We deserve just punishment for the wrong that we've done. And he turned to Jesus and said, Lord, remember me when you come into. See, Jesus saw the heart. And he said, man, that guy is broken. He's repented. He's contrite. People come to the altar. They're not broken over their sins. They're not contrite over what they've done. They don't even realize that they've done wrong, that they sinned against God. They don't even realize some of the commandments that they've broken. So how can they be saved? A man can't be saved unless he realizes he's perishing. If a guy is in a ocean or a pool, not over the pool, let's say this, a pond, he's in a lake or something like that, and he's encircled by some sharks or something like that, and he's just chilling and just laying on his back or whatever, this guy don't even realize he's in danger. There are people today that don't even realize they're in danger. How will they know they're in danger unless some preacher come and preach to them, guys, you are in trouble? That's what the gospel is for. It's to tell people that you're in trouble. You're out of fellowship with God. God's going to judge and punish sin. There's a day coming when he's going to judge the entire world. No flesh will be exempt from that judgment. You can't send your lawyer there. You will stand before the Lord, and he will judge you according to your works. But if you're not hearing that, beloved, guess what? You don't even realize that you're in trouble. So from my heart, I'm saying to you today, examine yourself. Prove whether you're in the faith or not. Make sure you have the right ingredients for salvation. Make sure you've repented of your sins. You have a remorseful. Listen, there's some things that I've done to people back in the day or whatever that I am so sorry for. Even to think about it, you know, it's like, for instance, you know, I was a person who was once an adulterer. Yes, I did. I committed adultery against other people and my wife that I was married to and another. What I'm saying is this, is that, you know, I'm so sorry that the sorrow that I feel and the remorse that I feel so much for it, I don't even watch shows on TV that has that. Whenever I see something on TV, if I'm looking at it, that's if I'm looking at it, and I see a scene whereby a man is cheating on his wife, I turn it off, I'll turn the channel because I am not interested. That thing broke me so bad that, come on, saints. I don't even want to entertain it because I hated it in my own life. I hated that I did it to someone else. So therefore, I don't even entertain it. So therefore, the brokenness, the humility, the contrition must be there. And the only thing that can produce that is the Holy Spirit. So when we come to God, we must come to God in a humble spirit. Examine yourself today. Make sure you're right with God. The signs are telling us that the end is near. Any day now, the great tribulation can start. And if you're here during that 7-year tribulation period, it's not going to be a party. Yeah, the saints will be gone already. But guess what? in the absence of light, darkness prevail. The only thing that's keeping Satan from coming full force with his troops and armies on the earth right now is what the Bible calls in 2 Thessalonians, the restrainer. But when the restrainer is taken away, that is, the Holy Spirit is taken out of the saints, the body of Christ, guess what's going to happen? All evil will abound. Some people will be glad the church is gone. But there are some people that will say, oh my God, what is going on? And I implore you today, my friend, I implore you from my heart. I come to encourage, but I also come to warn. The day is coming when the tribulation will begin. 7 years of tribulation. And then after that, the kingdom of God comes with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. He will come and rule and reign on the throne of his father David, as God promised the prophets in the scripture. So now is the time to get ready. Now is the time to get your house in order. Now is the time, if you're born again and in the kingdom of God, to stay where you are. The Bible said, they that are holy, let them be holy still. They that are righteous, let them be righteous still. Continue in the faith, my brother, my sister. But if you're not in the kingdom of God, whoever you are that are watching this, you may be watching to troll this channel, or you may be watching just to make criticisms and comments and things like that. That's very unnecessary. Because if you don't agree with what's being said, only thing you have to do is watch somebody else, or just don't watch at all. I'm here to tell you that there's a wrath of God that is coming upon this earth, and you can escape it. Remember, John the Baptist says, ye generation of vipers, who have warned you to flee the wrath of God, which is to come. I'm here today. I'm your John the Baptist saying, flee from the wrath of God, which is to come. The only thing that you can get safety in is the ark, and that ark is Jesus Christ himself. So now it's time for you to find God, and you can only find God the Father through the Son, Jesus Christ. So if you're ready to pray, and you're ready to stop playing with God, and you're ready to give your life over to him, I ask you and implore you right now, find you a place in your home, in your secret closet. I would like to lead you into a prayer, but listen, I believe it's the heartfelt prayer of a righteous man that avails much. But first of all, if you're not in him, if you're not righteous, then you need to start by telling the Lord you're unrighteous, you're unworthy. Tell him that you're a sinner and you need to be saved. And Jesus came into this world to save sinners, in which you are. So that's what you do. You repent of your sins. You said, just reconfess the sins. Somebody said, it's impossible for me to confess all my sins. That's true. Start with what you know. You know what you are. You say, well, that's unscriptural. Well, listen to this. When Jacob had an encounter with the angel, and I'm getting ready to close, when Jacob had that encounter with God, the question was asked, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. Well, if you look at the name of Jacob, you see what Jacob means, surplanter, schemer, con man, you know, all of these different things, liar, you know. So that's what Jacob was admitting. He was admitting his weakness. He was admitting his faults. And isn't that what the word of God says? Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another. So here it is. You say to God, Lord, I'm a whoremonger. I'm a drug addict. You know, I'm a liar. I'm a thief. I'm a robber. I've murdered someone. Whatever it is, you ask God, forgive you. And not only forgive you, repent. I'm going to stop doing this, and just tell the Lord that you need his grace, and his grace comes through salvation. Amen. It comes through salvation. In fact, the Bible says here, Titus chapter 3, verse number 3 says, for we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving various lusts and pleasures. See, that's your state now. Living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But when the kindness and the love of God, our Savior, towards men appear, not by works of righteousness which we've done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. See? So the grace of God will come. Only thing you have to do is tell the Lord, I'm so sorry. I broke your heart. I broke your commandments. I've done everything that my heart shared with me to do. But now I'm coming to turn it to you and turn my life over to you, trusting you. I believe with all my heart that God raised you from the dead, and I confess you as my Lord, and I'd be saved. God bless you. I thank you so much for watching this video. I pray that you would once again examine your life and then shoot this video over to somebody else, because there are some people I'm quite sure that they said, you know, hey, I know I'm saved. If I die, I'm going to heaven, you know. And you know, you need to make sure. Let's make sure the time is far spent. The day is at hand. And let us cast off the works of darkness. Father, thank you so much for this time with my friend, my brother, my sister, those that are watching or those that are listening to this by way of YouTube. I ask you, Father, the Holy Spirit, to search our hearts. Search us and know our hearts. Try us, know our thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Thank you so much for your word, for your gospel. Thank you so much for your Holy Spirit. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. And God bless you. Well, thank you for joining me today for this short but brief and important telecast. I hope to see you sometime soon as we continue to put out more videos that's going to help you, change you, and revolutionize your life. This is Kenneth Dentley. Until next time, God bless you.